one's looking ugly, but maybe spring will come and I should plant something there, and ooh, that one's past ready to be harvested. And as with gardening, you can always recycle the bottom bits. And then I thought, no, I know so little about gardening that really it won't take me past two sentences. So then I thought, I'll call it Seven Ways Creativity is Like Kid Stuff, because kids are just intrinsically creative. They're like mini gods, you know, that my son gets on Minecraft, and he's just not remotely inhibited about the idea of dreaming up a planet from scratch. But then I thought, I talk about my kids enough, so let's not do it tonight. So finally I decided to call my talk, it's real title, which I didn't want to put in the program, Seven Ways Creativity is Like Sex. Reason number one, it takes an ordinary situation and it makes it buzz with excitement. The thing about sex is that you take things that were there 10 minutes ago, you know, legs, fingers, mouth, lips, and you put them together and suddenly you've got a thunderstorm. I would say that a scene in a novel doesn't have to be about something intrinsically exciting, it's just the writer has to make it sound exciting. And I think the writer needs to be feeling excited themselves. I think if you're not feeling thrilled, why on earth would your readers? So I try and put myself in a state of regular, intense excitement. Now, sometimes in the middle of writing a scene, sometimes it does occur to me that what is exciting me may not excite all my readers. I mean, my tastes are a little bit specialist. I write about things like, my last novel, when I mentioned it to a journalist that I was writing about a cross-dressing frog capture in 19th century San Francisco, he said, good one, but in fact, that was true. But at least when I'm writing, I'm having fun, and you never know, the reader might too. Reason number two, creativity is like sex. There are no rules about where and when you get creative. So long as, to quote Mrs. Patrick Campbell on two male actors, who don't do it in the street and scare the horses. I would say you can't force creativity to happen, but you can certainly set the right conditions, for you, whether that be flying at 30,000 feet or with candles and an open fire or rock climbing or in a dark cinema. And as with sex, clearing your schedule and leaving your mind time to wander can certainly help. The muse is an unreliable guest, but you can keep an eye out for her, welcome her in. Keep an open mind always about when and where. For instance, when we were going to have kids, I had this completely unrealistic image of how I would write novels with a child, baby cooing in a rocking bassinet by my side. And that's never in fact happened, but I have had plenty of quick and dirty writing sessions while my kids are in tennis lessons here at Western in the big bubble. I sit there with my laptop for an hour and a half writing good stuff, but ignoring my children. Reason number three, creativity is like sex. There are no rules about who you do it with. You could do it with one other person or with hundreds, whatever rings your bell. For instance, under certain circumstances, I would collaborate for a while. Sometimes with a theatre company, I would have about 3 weeks of intense collaboration, and I get crushes on all of them. And then afterwards, there's an anti-climax, but there's also a certain relief as I head back to my solitary writing office. And I think, well, at least I know what I like here, and at least I'm always on top. Don't think of writing as a lonely business. I would say I'm not spending my days alone. I'm with all my little characters in my head, particularly as I often write about the dead, the real dead, and they're often obscure real dead. They're not Henry VIII. So I feel a lot of grateful for my paying them attention. And because they have certain facts about their lives, I find it sticks those long dead people kind of wrestle with me and say, it wasn't like that, it's like this. And even if it's invented characters I'm working on, even they become what Chris calls my imaginary friends. They seem to take on a life of their own and they say things like, I wouldn't do that on page 5. Reason number four, it's just like this, is that there are no rules about what to do or how to do it. You can write a book backwards, forwards. You can, once my dad wanted to write a memoir and he'd only ever written literary criticism, just to get past it anyway, he wrote it on postcards, random postcards, and then put it together afterwards. You can edit a lot or not at all. You can show it to your writing circle or show it to nobody. Fountain pen, laptop, doesn't matter. My only rule is when the school bus takes children away, I go to my computer and I see what happens. What happens is sometimes online shopping, but not every day. Again, like sex, that feels completely an unproductive use of my time, and it's thrilling, and it refreshes me, and it means that when in 5 years I finally get to writing that book, I've done a lot of the work already. So I would highly recommend trying a genre you've never tried before. I most recently tried murder mystery. I was terrified I'd get it wrong. I'm now trying writing children's fiction. It's always good to draw on that feeling of stage fright, that feeling of I'm going to open my mouth without in public. Now, again, like sex, reason number six, there are dry patches, and you must not panic. Keep showing up, you keep holding hands with your muse, even if you're not jumping her bones, you keep her company, treat her like a lady. And luckily, there's a lot to be done in most artistic projects that is not itself wildly creative. A lot of a novel is just moving bits around and trying to make them fit, so you can always do that. And if you stay with it,